Hi, I'm Spencer Critchley, sitting in this week for Jeff Pevere. In Hollywood, a kiss is still a kiss, a sigh is still a sigh. But when is a deal still a deal? That's the question being asked in TinselTown since actress Kim Basinger backed out of a movie and got slapped with a multi-million dollar lawsuit. Tonight on Primetime, The Art of the Deal in Hollywood. Sealing a business deal with a handshake is the sort of thing you only see in movies, right? Wrong. Believe it or not, the people who make those movies, specifically in Hollywood, still rely on the simple handshake rather than a written contract to make deals. But now this informal practice is being disputed in court, and the case involves movie star Kim Basinger. Andrew Martin joins Primetime occasionally to guide us through Hollywood's twists and turns. He's with me tonight from Washington, D.C. Hi, Andrew.
How are you?
Oh, I'm just fine. How are you?
Okay.
Can you tell me in a nutshell, Andrew, what is the Kim Basinger case all about?
Well, it involves this whole legal notion of breach of verbal contract. Let me just take you a little bit back into time and talk about the film at hand. It's a film called Boxing Helena. And back in early 1991, Kim Basinger had expressed interest in acting in this movie called Boxing Helena. And she had met with the director of the movie and talked about its various aspects. Up until 4 weeks prior to shooting the movie, Mainline Pictures, which produces Boxing Helena, was under the impression that Kim Basinger was going to still star in it. She had left every impression that she was going to do that. But 4 weeks prior to principal photography beginning, she pulled out and leaves Mainline Pictures in the lurch. Mm-hmm. They had spent at that point about $500,000 in pre-production costs. They had built sets, and they were all ready to go. All the other stars were lined up. But Kim Basinger was the main star, and she pulls out, and Mainline Pictures was facing tremendous losses in promised overseas revenues to be earned by Boxing Helena with Kim Basinger. So they took, Mainline Pictures took Kim Basinger to court, claiming that she had breached this contract that they had reached in 1991.
And I assume they're suing her for a big pile of money.
They are suing her for over $6 million, which is the estimated amount of money that Mainline Pictures would have garnered in foreign rights mm-hmm. for the movie.
So what made them think they had a deal?
They were under the very strong impression that, first of all, there were 6 to 8 deal memos that were passed around between Mainline and Kim Basinger. They had shaken hands on the actual sort of bare outlines of the movie, and they were under the very strong impression that Basinger was very enthused about the script. So there were the initial signs, in addition to that all-important handshake, we're all there.
How common is a handshake, though, as a way to seal a deal in Hollywood?
It's very, very common. This is why this case has sort of got a lot of people in Hollywood shaking their heads. So many deals happen so many days of the week that you couldn't possibly have lawyers and their hangers-on constantly attending meetings and pounding out various contracts for every stage of how a film is put together. So through a lot of the initial stages of putting a film together, handshakes are exchanged. Things are jotted down on cocktail napkins at various rendezvous points throughout Hollywood. And it just sort of lubricates the whole process to be able to trust the verbal agreement by talent, whether it's a star or a director or producer, that they will be able to participate in the upcoming project. You know, Mainline Pictures was very, very interested in knowing that Kim Basinger, in, they estimated, 6 of her last 9 movies, never had a contract at all.
Oh, is that right?
And those movies were made, and Kim Basinger starred in them, and so they had every reason to believe that those movies were based upon verbal contracts, that was sort of the currency mm-hmm. of Hollywood. And the thing, though, is that eventually, with all that in mind, eventually you do have to get down to a written contract. I mean, there are too many lawyers in Hollywood to not have a written contract signed.
Well, I want to ask you, though, Andrew, but from the point of view of the actor, I think you're talking mainly from the point of view of the producers and getting the deals made, but what for an actor, what defines commitment?
Well, commitment is for the actor. At least, say, look at the SAG, the Screen Actors Guild rules. They say that if the actor is wardrobed, and if the actor, in other words, if the actor is fitted for all the various costumes that he or she's going to wear, and if they receive a final script, then it is pretty well understood, short of the final contract that is being hammered out by the lawyers, it is understood that that actor is then involved and fully participating in the project.
And the producers and the studios, they've traditionally been comfortable with that as a definition of commitment?
Well, they learn to live with it. They learn to live with it. They essentially say they are happy to go along with that in addition to putting together a paper trail of deal memos that sort of chart every aspect of the negotiation. And so when a particular large aspect of the negotiation between actor and producer and studio is arranged, such as salary, then a deal memo is exchanged confirming that this has been done orally. And this is all sort of accumulated, this paper trail, so that a final contract that probably is nailed down maybe halfway through the shoot of a movie, or perhaps even at the end of a movie shoot, that is finally done, but they've accumulated enough material to essentially nail the actor, the actress into the commitment.
Well, given though that the producers and studios have been comfortable with the idea that the final commitment is showing up and getting costumed and that sort of thing, what kind of case do you think that Mainline has in this suit against Kim Basinger?
Well, there are two sort of avenues that Mainline is taking in a lot of ways. One is the very self-righteous one of sort of saying, we would like to change the way Hollywood does business. We would like to try to get actors and actresses and directors and other prestigious talent to stick to their verbal commitments. We would like to add more muscle to the commitment than what is essentially this sort of ephemeral kind of quality. From a practical standpoint, one has to appreciate a little bit of the so-called background or backstory of this particular case. Mainline is a small independent company. They had a lot of prestige riding on Kim Basinger's involvement in this picture. And using Kim Basinger, taking advantage of her name, they went out and garnered a lot of money and a lot of sort of foreign sales, wholly based upon Kim Basinger's anticipated participation. When she drops out, Mainline is left looking pretty terrible. Mm-hmm. So what they would like to do, Mainline really feels that this sort of thing should be avoided in the future by both facing independent companies like themselves, in addition to the big studios.
And I guess it does mean a lot more to them than it would to somebody like Disney.
It means an awful lot more. It's interesting that you mentioned Disney, because Disney, as it turns out, is very picky-uny about its contracts, and it tends to avoid the final verbal agreement and sticks to insisting on having a contract with everyone before the first frame of film is shot.
Now, what reasons did she give for backing out of Boxing Helena?
Well, these were sort of shifting all over the lot. She said that at first she was very pleased with the script, and Mainline Pictures likes to throw around the adjective that Kim Basinger used. She called it magical. But then later on in the game, she thought that the script had some severe problems, notably that there was too much nudity for her taste. There was also the matter of Jennifer Lynch, the director of the movie, is a first-time director. She is the daughter of Schockmeister David Lynch, so that would certainly guarantee an interesting shoot, but nonetheless, she is a first-time director and quite green. And on the one hand, Basinger wanted to be sort of using some noblesse oblige and sort of say, I will help this first-time director out. On the other hand, late in the game, like around 4 weeks before photography was to begin, she got cold feet and she said, well, wait a minute, am I going to trust my rather precarious career at this point to a first-time director? So she had problems with Jennifer Lynch's lack of experience.
Well, you know, let's just take those sex scenes. Kim Basinger has done nude scenes before. One thinks of 9.5 weeks as a notable example. Why is she suddenly so sensitive about nude scenes?
Well, because you have to remember when 9.5 weeks already goes back now several years, and in fact, I almost have a private little theory that nude scenes and the number of them and the explicit the explicitness of them is directly proportional to the inexperience and the greenness of the actor or the actress. Kim Basinger's nude scenes and their explicit nature were largely done when she was just an up-and-coming actress. And oftentimes, when you are just an up-and-coming actress, you don't have much clout. You don't have much say in how a script is put together and how many nude scenes are there going to be shot. Kim Basinger is now, at age 39, a pretty well-seasoned actress who had, on the strength of Batman, a lot of clout in Hollywood, so she can put her foot down and say, forget about my past, forget about the steamy scenes in 9.5 weeks. I have a lot of clout in this town, and I'm going to insist that certain things be done my way. Let me give you a very recent example of a movie that's just come out that really can show how an actress has clout in terms of whether nude scenes are used or not. There's a movie out called Untamed Heart with starring Marissa Tomei. She was in My Cousin Vinny, successful movie. Mm-hmm. In Untamed Heart, Marissa Tomei participates in a couple of very tastefully done love scenes. And in both of those love scenes, there is never any frontal nudity showed. There is only her very attractive naked back. and in any scenes where you might have sort of frontal shots of her, she has kept her bra on. That is not a coincidence. I am almost positive that somebody of Marissa Tomei's newfound clout in Hollywood has insisted that that be done that way.
Gosh, it's so cold sounding. You know, you can almost imagine concocting an index for actresses on their way through their careers. You might have a paper doll that you gradually put more clothes back onto as they achieve stature in the industry.
Well, Meryl Streep is master of the fully clothed bedroom scene.
I suppose so. Gosh.
And that reflects her. That reflects her taste.
Yeah.
Not necessarily the taste and the inclination of the director or the producer.
Now, Andrew, surely other actors have shaken hands on a project and then backed out later. How has this problem been dealt with in the past?
Well, what happens is that if it involves a major studio, it is a very, very hushed up kind of thing. Because, in fact, it happens rather often. The major studio pretends to understand very well and acquiesces with the actor, and they arrange to have the actor participate in a future film. And they just sort of, some money is exchanged, but it is all done on a very hush-hush basis, and because a gag order is sort of imposed on all the players, and one never really hears about it. There's been a recent example involving Woody Harrelson after his great performance in White Men Can't Jump. He became a very, very popular and very strong actor in Hollywood. He was offered a very small movie by MGM called Benny and June, which he took, but that was before he became so popular as a result of White Men Can't Jump. And when that movie became the box office success that it did, he backed out of the MGM movie to take the more sexy and prestigious high-profile movie called Indecent Proposal with Robert Redford and Demi Moore. Mm-hmm. Here is an example of a case where Woody Harrelson backs out, and in fact it is Paramount Pictures which is producing the movie Indecent Proposal, which had to compensate MGM, as I'm told, for the services of Woody Harrelson. But this is all something that goes on very much behind the scenes, and not very many people know about it.
Well, why do you think Mainline is suing and doing, you know, bringing it all out from behind the scenes if this handshake arrangement and this backing out stuff has been relatively common in the past?
First of all, I think they're very, very upset and embarrassed, and from a financial standpoint, they're probably reeling. This is somewhat of a catastrophic turn of events for them, because this movie, it had a budget of $9.6 million, and because Kim Basinger drops out of it, it drops down to about $4 million or something. So it's cut in half. There are very practical reasons for why they're bringing this case to court. They would like to get some sort of retribution for this particular film. In the long term, they would like to, I think they honestly would like to see Hollywood change its ways and develop less ephemeral, less sort of handshake-based agreements and more legalized paper trail agreements between studio and actor to prevent this kind of thing happening in the future.
Do you think this case is going to have an impact on the way deals are made in Hollywood?
if Kim Basinger loses, if Mainline wins, I think that there's going to be a sort of a chilling effect. There will be a certain amount of caution introduced, more caution, if you will, introduced into this rather freewheeling sort of slap your back kind of policy and process in Hollywood, where deals are sort of struck in restaurants and on the golf course. You're going to see more paper, more documents, more signing of documents, lawyers probably introduced earlier on into the process, and perhaps a lot less handshaking and a lot more writing of the actual steps in the process. It will become more picayune, it will become more meticulous as a process, and it will perhaps sort of introduce less trust and more legalese into what has been really a process based largely on relationships.
Well, one, of course, is entirely confident that a greater role for lawyers will lead to greater work being done on the screen. When is the case expected to wrap up, Andrew?
In about 10 days or so, and the betting in Hollywood is that Kim Basinger will win, because Mainline is really trying to set a precedent, and as the law tells us, that's not so easy to do.
Andrew Martin looks at films and Hollywood for Primetime from time to time, and he joined me this evening from Washington, D.C. Thanks, Andrew.
Thank you.
Music from a band called The Laws. From their self-titled and so far only album, we heard Doldrum. Coming up in just a few minutes, Primetime's regular film columnist Kevin Currier will be joining me. He's been wondering why movies like Passionfish and Peter's Friends appeal so much to the baby boom generation. Kevin has come to some provocative conclusions, and he'll share them with me a little later. I'm Spencer Critchley, and I'm holding down the fort this week while Jeff is away on vacation. You're listening to Primetime on CBC Radio.
Coming soon from Paramount Pictures, A unique motion picture experience for a unique audience. It's the movie for people named Gene. Starring Gene Hackman, Gene Simmons, and Eugene Levy. Easily one of the best movies in the history of the cinema, says Gene Siskel. Pure genius. I felt as though it spoke to me personally, says Gene Shalit. A truly awful piece of trash, says Leonard Maltin. The movie for people named Gene, also starring Gina Davis, based on a screenplay by Gene Roddenberry. Special appearance by Barbara Eden. The movie for people named Gene, rated G.
It's music by Gene Vincent. Now that's a concept film. That was also the comedy of Radio Free Vestibule. Crash Vegas released their debut album almost 3 years ago now. Due to a changing roster and various other difficulties, it's taken them until now to release a follow-up. From Stone, this is Gold and Silver.
Thank you.
crash Vegas with gold and silver. Recently, movies like Passionfish and Peter's Friends have been luring large numbers of baby boomers into the theater. With the use of familiar music, whiffs of nostalgia, and the promise of renewal and redemption, these movies seem to strike a powerful chord with increasingly world-weary yuppies. But whatever the calming message of hope these movies purport to offer, Kevin Currier believes they're evidence of a generation deeply in denial. Kevin is Prime Time's regular film columnist. He joins me tonight. Hi, Kevin.
Hi, Spencer.
Well, you're making a potentially controversial statement here, I would say.
Nothing new, I guess.
So why don't we start by explaining, first of all, what Passionfish and Peter's Friends are all about.
Sure. Well, Passionfish was directed by John Sayles and stars Mary McDonnell as a soap opera star who's crippled in a car accident. Now, she's very bitter and resentful following the accident, so she returns to her home in Louisiana to indulge her self-pitying. While there, she meets a black nurse played by Alfred Woodard and a Cajun fisherman who help her find psychic healing and spiritual renewal. Now, Peter's Friends is directed by and stars Kenneth Branagh, who we know from Henry V and Dead Again. Mm-hmm. And it's the kind of 90s equivalent of The Big Chill for the 70s generation, in that it's about a group of friends who get together for the first time in 10 years. And as they renew their friendships, they uncover each other's problems, you know, like decaying marriages, deaths, alcoholism, you know, the usual stuff. They're all absorbed with their own problems, in other words, until they discover that their selfless leader, Peter, has worse problems than any of them. And they realize just how self-absorbed they've been and begin to understand the importance of friendship as a healing force.
Okay, I want to get back to those films in just a little bit, but first of all, you mentioned The Big Chill.
Right.
Is that movie the archetype for this kind of movie?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, except for a small cult film called The Return of the Secaucus 7, which, coincidentally enough, was made by John Sayles, The Big Chill was the first movie to specifically address the generation who came of age in the 60s. Most people, I think, know the plot, because it's been seen by quite a few people, but for those who haven't seen it in a while, the movie itself centers on a group of former activists who have gathered at the funeral of their friend and mentor, Alex, who's committed suicide. This film, if you recall, had a profound impact on baby boomers. It attracted huge audiences, launched the careers of many of the actors in it, spawned look-alike TV commercials, and even led to the rise, I think, of radio stations playing rock from the late 60s, mm-hmm. and helped create this very nostalgic craze for 60s culture.
Now, why do you think it had that kind of profound impact?
Well, I think because on the surface, at least, Spencer, it addressed the question of how time had changed the members of that generation. Here was a generation who grew up thinking that social change was possible and who actively tried to do something about it. But the reality is that the world didn't change overnight, and now they're too old to do anything about it. Some of the former social activists have turned inward. Others we know have become more conservative as they worry about their own financial and family responsibilities. And in The Big Chill, they were able to lament their lost activism and idealism without any of the personal sacrifices usually demanded by these kinds of actions. The Big Chill is the kind of movie that can have a scene where a wife asks her husband to bed her friend in order to get her pregnant, and it's treated in terms of bonding their values rather than looking at the tension that might have been developed over the years that might have made a decision like that one difficult. The Big Chill acknowledged the change in emphasis in the lives of the baby boom generation, but addressed it, I think, in superficial terms. And baby boomers were gratified, I think, just to see some of their own concerns up there on the movie screen.
Now, you're saying superficial, but what was so superficial, really, about The Big Chill's take on the baby boom generation?
Well, if you look at it closely, it's basically saying, I think, that the liberals of the 60s have either committed suicide, like their dear friend Alex, sold out to the establishment, like, the movie star character Tom Berenger played, or be neutralized like the impotent drug addict that William Hurt played. I mean,
well, when you put it that way.
Yeah. Well, with all those examples, it says very clearly that it's a very cold world out there.
So what do you think? If you'd been in touch with him, you could have saved his life? You have that kind of effect on the people in your life? You keep them all jolly, do you? Wise up, folks. We're all alone out there, and tomorrow we're going out there again. I think it was damn straight of Alex not to cook up some neat, phony Reader's Digest condensation of his screwed-up life for our entertainment. I am so sick of people selling their psyches for a little attention. He was classier than that.
Yeah, it was a real classy act he pulled in the bathtub.
Hey, you know, for some people it isn't a question of why to kill yourself, but why not?
Yes, I do believe you can help other people, Nick. I really do. Sorry about that.
I do too, Nick. Not that you can save them. Probably not. But you can do what you can do. That's how I feel.
So you're gonna continue to love me no matter what, huh?
Just don't cross me.
So you see, Spencer, as that clip demonstrates, the movie softens its harshness by appealing to the sentimental notion that the bonding of friends can heal the wounds of alienation. And by warming up the coldness, by pairing people up to heal each other, this will in turn give you a second chance of renewal. Well, much like the example I mentioned earlier where Glenn Close gives her husband up, Kevin Kline, to Mary Kay Place for the purposes of conception. The other thing the movie does, too, is it plays music from the period of the 60s that identifies a very particular aspect of that culture and, of course, appeals to us nostalgically. The movie admits that each of the people in this movie are somehow dysfunctional because they've turned their backs on their ideals. But the movie makes no attempt to explain why their ideals were abandoned. And it never addresses the fact that for all their activism, these 60s radicals were completely unable to change the world. The final message of the film is that by renewing old friendships, you can get a second chance at saving yourself. And I think that's a superficial solution to the kinds of problems that this movie touches on.
I can hear the phones ringing now.
Where?
You obviously don't have a lot of love for The Big Chill, but it was hugely popular.
Yes, it was.
And it did seem to become an archetype for films of this sort. What do you think picked up from The Big Chill, though? We've mentioned Peter's Friends and Passionfish. Was there anything in between The Big Chill and those films?
Yeah, I think probably the most effective example I can think of is the movie Field of Dreams, a movie that left, I think, many of my friends in tears after they saw it. But this film is a very conservative movie disguised in counterculture clothes. Once again, I'm sure most people have seen the film, but briefly, Kevin Costner plays this once radical farmer who broke with his father at a very young age and is now struggling with his own family and his loss of ideals. In his discontentment, he hears a voice saying one night, "If you build it, he will come." He doesn't know what or who, but he builds a baseball diamond and then sets off on a quest. What he's ultimately searching for is a second chance to reconcile with his father. In other words, to turn his back on the decisions that he'd made as a 60s radical. In the process, Spencer, everybody and everything gets a second chance. The 1917 Chicago Black Sox, a scandalized team, get a chance to play baseball again on that field of dreams he's just built. And an embittered solitary writer, who in the novel was J.D. Salinger, but here as a radical black writer, is offered a chance to regain his faith in humanity, which he does through the love of baseball.
Ray, people will come, Ray. They'll come to Iowa for reasons they can't even fathom. They turn up your driveway, not knowing for sure why they're doing it. They'll arrive at your door as innocent as children, longing for the past.
The one constant through all the years, Ray, has been baseball. America has rolled by like an army of steamrollers. It's been erased like a blackboard, rebuilt and erased again. But baseball mark the time. This field, this game, it's a part of our past, Ray. It reminds us of all that once was good and it could be again. Oh, people will come, Ray. People will most definitely come.
Now, come on. I mean, this sludge made me yell out loud in the theater because, of course, he's a black man, and due to segregation, he would not have even been allowed to play baseball for half the century, let alone it being a constant in American life.
You spoil sport.
Well, I mean, the movie rewrites and mystifies history for its own advantages. Baseball, in fact, in Field of Dreams becomes a metaphor for conformity because at the end, the message you're left with is, well, play ball with Dad, play catch with him, and Dad's values while you're at it. In other words, just go along with the mainstream.
Well, you know, now that I think of it, I guess we haven't seen too many films about people in the 60s continuing with what they were doing, like organizing farm workers or becoming civil rights lawyers or that sort of thing. And I guess we could imagine an alternate future extending from the 60s where we would see films about people doing that. But no, it's this kind of hazy nostalgia for that.
Yeah, unless you want to include documentaries, of course. I mean, I think there are documentaries being made about people who are still socially active. I think a great example is Barbara Kopple's documentary American Dream, which did win an Academy Award a couple years ago about a labor strike and the divisiveness within this labor movement in the States. But this is not the kind of movie that becomes popular in movie theaters. It's more like one that you might see on PBS or perhaps in a rep house.
Now, I think you've made your point that these films are superficial, and they deny that that counterculture heritage, perhaps strangled at birth.
Well, but, rebelliousness, yes.
But why really? Why is the baby boom generation so enamored of this sort of film?
Well, I think because people don't want to face the fact that they might have failed, especially on their ideals and their hopes for a better world, and I think. It comes down to this. In hindsight, it is now apparent that some of the idealism of the 60s was misguided. There were some criminal elements at work, like the weathermen, for instance, and bombing buildings, and it did get pretty nasty in the early 70s. And some people, I think, were naive in ways that, when the way they tried to promote change. And if you look at the Nixon era in the early 70s, it pretty much demoralized even those with the best intentions. So basically, these movies are historical rewrites for liberals, a chance to feel good and feel better. Much like the Rambo movies, I think, were historical recreations for conservatives, so they could go back and win the Vietnam War. These movies are like celluloid cheerleaders. And although today's baby boomers are older, less adventurous, they have more financial and family responsibility, and I'd also like to say they're more timid, probably more cautious, because they don't want to face the same kinds of social upheaval that was part of the 60s. They want security, and what better way to find security but in the love of friends?
So how do Passionfish and Peter's friends fit into this?
Well, I think it's a question of both movies being informed by mortality, by the knowledge that things can't last. But they both suggest that renewal is right around the corner. And like the other movies we've discussed, they do that by denying some very basic points. For example, in Passionfish, it's never made clear how a black woman with severe problems like a newly beaten drug addiction, a questionable boyfriend that she has, a father who's rejected her, and a child she's never seen, makes friends with a wealthy, selfish, self-indulgent white woman. The movie completely avoids issues like race, power relationships that can develop there, class distinctions. You know from the outset, even when they're bickering in the beginning, that they're going to be sisters under the skin. And Peter's friends, I think, fully supports the notion that friendship conquers all. The world is a cold place, once again, like in The Big Chill, but the comfort of friends will save you. All of the movies we've talked about tonight, I think, are big security blankets for a generation who's lost sight of their ideals, I think. But these are blankets that don't give comfort, Spencer. I say they smother you.
Well, now, I think I agree with you about Peter's friends. I had a hard time learning to like the characters in that movie just because they were so self-absorbed. But I liked Passionfish a little better, and I think I liked it at least because we saw the Alfre Woodard character rebuking the Mary McDonnell character. There was at least some kind of confrontation there.
There was in the beginning, but I tended to think it was more like a signpost for things to come because it avoided some of the specifics of the conflicts that would go on between them, some of the things that I mentioned. And instead, it was that kind of contentiousness you get in sitcoms. It's sort of a signal that later on, they're going to become good buddies. Mm-hmm. That it kind of, it signaled what was to come for me rather than explore the very issues that were there.
We knew they'd be pals.
We knew they'd be pals, exactly.
Kevin Currier is Primetime's regular movie columnist. Thanks for coming in, Kevin.
Thank you, Spencer.
Coming home with the spring. Got my suitcase in my hand. I wrote this letter so you would understand. Don't you worry about a thing, oh. Don't you worry. Worry about a thing, oh. Don't you worry. Worry. Like a fish caught out of water, fell in love with the butcher's daughter. Now you're smoking like a burning house. You can't be the cat or you can be the mouse. Don't you worry about a thing, no. Don't you worry.
From their debut effort, No Singing at the Dinner Table, that was Watertown with Don't You Worry. Where would you look if you needed information about such diverse subjects as serial killers, the Iran-Contra scandal, the Gulf War, or AIDS? I'm sure a lot of possibilities come to mind, but I'm also sure that trading cards aren't among them. Catherine Ironwood publishes a series called True Crime Trading Cards, as well as cards that deal with everything else I just mentioned. Catherine Ironwood will join me tomorrow night. Up next, a little jazz, courtesy of bassist Kieran Overs, who joins horn player Kevin Turcotte, pianist Brian Dickinson, drummer Bob McLaren, and guitarist Lorna Lofsky. This is With the Wind and the Rain in Her Hair. ¶¶ Kieran Overs with some of Canada's best jazz instrumentalists. From the album Gateway, we heard With the Wind and the Rain in Her Hair. If you'd like to comment on anything you've heard on tonight's program or on previous editions of Primetime, we'd like to hear from you. We welcome any thoughts you'd care to pass along. So write to us and we'll try to read your letter on the air. Our address is Primetime, CBC Radio, P.O. Box 500, Station A, Toronto, Ontario, M5W1E6. That's our show for this evening. I'm Spencer Critchley. Thanks for listening and see you tomorrow.